TV Empire to director, we have a player review. Can we rock and roll, please?
Hello and welcome to Bits and Pieces, the friendliest cricket podcast. We are recording on October 13, 2024, and this is episode 142. 142, of course, is the answer to life, the universe and everything, plus a glorious 100. And this week, we have discovered that the joy of cricket can be unlocked and you can have the answer to everything if you have a Malayali who believes in Sanju Samson opening for your team and setting the stage for the rest of the players to come in and do their things. That's right. I am Tony and I'm back as an opener for Bits and Pieces. I bring the 42 a day after Sanju Samson has brought up a glorious 100. Joining me, the self-proclaimed wordplay expert, is the man who was the first to the perfect pun yesterday. The one who described Sanju's century as a Chetan, the magician from Europe who can tie you up in knots of laughter, the hot boy for whom you immorally sat up hopping, it is Murali Sargopan. Say hi, Murali.
Hey guys, thank you. Pleasure to be back on the pod again. Thanks for the lovely intro.
And joining us, the man who claims he has seen talent dawning before it was born, the man who can see men even in seamen. He was there with a jinx even before they erected the Sphinx. He scouts, he spouts, he touts, he seldom shouts. The man who crows so wisdom dawns on us. Wake up, suba ho gaye mamu. Say hi to Vamu.
Hey, hi. Yeah.
Yeah.
And rounding up the panel, the man who believes in taking the scenic storytelling route before he gets to the point because he wants the step marks, and his name is Max. He makes the sum greater than its parts, the man from Detroit with an incredible hit rate. Say hi, Mayur, Max, Davinci.
Hey, nice to see all of you on the pod, guys.
Man, can we just say... The people have been complaining about our cadence, and you know that whole thing about footprints in the sand, no? Like, so far, close to 130 episodes, we've been diligently putting out episodes week on week. We didn't give a chance for people to complain. But now there are actual listeners who are saying, we have noted that you've slipped away from your weekly cadence. You have to put two episodes as a remedy, etc., etc. People have also noted, other panelists' absence from the podcast and all. So, mildly feeling validated, guys. So, also a resolve to say that we will continue this podcast in a weekly format, hopefully from now. How does it feel to be wanted? Here also, Sanju Samson, not selected.
Not selected.
Then one thing I have to say. Like, after missing the pod last week, or like we've been a bit inconsistent, like you put so much preparation today for intro and all that. One fellow has, like, after Sanju Chetan's exploits yesterday, like, worn a t-shirt with proper Mohanlal playing pickleball and all that. And you have, like, made zero reference to that, da.
To be honest, we assume this is an audio-first podcast, right? And like, I think Max already has some prepared remarks around his t-shirt. So Max, why don't we start with it? Describe what you're wearing in 50 shades of grey, apparently.
This girliest t-shirt is Laleton with a paddle in his hand. That's why it says A10. And it reads paddle evida.
No, paddle evida. Okay. Well, yeah.
Wow. In the world of like basketball and volleyball, lal ball is truly winning.
Mamu, this is actually quite reminiscent of this week because I opened like Pakistan first innings putting up in excess of 500 and all. And Max has just handed me an innings defeat by wearing this t-shirt. So, why don't we begin there in the glorious world of Pakistan cricket? I would like to specifically contextualize this in Shan Masood's press conferences. Because as much as I have not been following the action, it is easy enough to follow what Shan Masood has been saying. And also be like, bro, like, which team are you playing for? Like, what is going on?
This has been a glorious Pakistan week. It has given us everything that is Pakistan. You've had some hope, then you've had abject failure, and then when you think it cannot get worse, it actually gets worse. And then when you think that all the pain and suffering is done, just now, again, this is 7 in the morning for me, but I have woken up to read some of the most fabulous pieces of, you know, galaxy brain that has come out of Pakistan, where, members of the team have been dropped. So starting from Monday, like, I think it was someone who said, who scheduled the test match on a Monday? I think that Pakistan should only schedule test matches on Monday. Because Monday to Friday, they'll play a test. Saturday, Sunday, they'll come up with galaxy brain ideas. And then again, we'll go to a test. They have scored 500 twice now. They lost against Bangladesh. Now they lost against England from that position. They have let go of arguably their best batter. And now they're going to play the very same pitch. This cannot happen anywhere. This is not like a joke that has been written. This is like reality that's unfolding in front of our eyes. It's fabulous.
In the world of cinema and art and all, there are these 4 or 5 common tropes, right? There is a hero redemption arc. A hero will go through a difficult time, but at the end, the hero will win. There will be difficult challenges along the way. Pakistan found a way to write inverses of those kind of parameters. Like, if great things could look like they could happen in your life, you could see diamonds, but you will eventually eat shit. Like, we will go to the bottom and somehow dig further. Like, every time they've gotten the tiniest bit of a good day, they've somehow found ways to dig so deep. So, on day one, and of course, it's beautiful because Pakistan commentators are a special breed. Day one, during Shaan Masood's innings, right? They talked about it like the Ganguly of Pakistan had walked in. Some of the shots, the number of times they used the word stamp of authority, he must have started with rubber stamp office only. Like, he'd been stamping across the ground. He's stamping with cover drive, stamping with the edge flying off. He's always stamping. And then the 50 was, it was a mark of respect. And the 100 was, he's shown as a captain how to truly lead. He's been through difficult times, but now he's truly brought them out of the weeds. That was the last moment of any happiness from any Pakistan commentator, day one afternoon. Ever since, it was such a bad slide, like the fielding, the everything. Like, the umpires looked good amidst all the bullshit that was happening. It was that bad to see this test match unfold. I feel really bad as a Pakistan fan. Like, I cannot imagine how they could play cricket like that.
Yeah, I mean, I think two things to say here, right? One, when you say stamp of authority, this is a week in which Mohammad Siraj has become DSP Mohammad Siraj. And I feel like when they said stamp of authority for any Pakistan player, it is that now you can retire and become a gazetted officer, because that is all you're good to do. Stamp of authority for people who come and say, please ratify my identity. And I think you also mentioned that you never feel like with Pakistan, this is the end, right? Or like in the words of our friend Max Da Vinci quoting some Bollywood movie, picture abhi bhi baki hai. And picture abhi bhi baki hai actually happened for Babar Azam, because after a humiliating test match defeat and like poor performances, he went back and the picture that was baki is the picture of him on hotspot. His dismissal is shown, yeah. And the hotspot shows him farting. It has caught that moment. Okay. It is like humiliation max.
You can actually traverse Babar Azam's downfall to till the day he shook hands with Virat Kohli.
Not shook hands, no, where he tweeted,
put out that tweet.
This too shall pass.
I know, and then yeah. After that, when they met, he shook hands and patted him on the shoulder and all that. That is when the, you know, exchange of tectonic forces, energy transfer happened. Because since then, because imagine, before that, Babar had played in that World Cup, T20 World Cup in Sharjah. He had a pretty good World Cup. They went to the finals and all that. Once he shook hands, that energy transfer happened. Because until then, Kohli was in an absolute lean patch. Then Kohli started not like becoming Rooteshwar, but at least, you know, decently enough to still warrant his place in the team. And poor Babar, you know, the slide has just gone crazy. Like, now, you cannot drop him, man. No matter what, how can you? This doesn't make sense. Babar, Naseem, Shaheen have been dropped.
What about Shaan Masood?
Shaan Masood is writing ILTS, no? He's preparing for ILTS. But during this, one more thing has happened, right? They have a new selection committee headed by Aqib Javed. Aqib Javed, Asad Shafiq, Aleem Dar, the umpire who just retired, right? He just retired in, and he's immediately in the selection committee. that new selection committee met without the captain and the coach.
They selected Aleem Dar because Dar ke aage jeet hai. So like, I assume like if he's put in, like they'll start winning us.
And just like how other Pakistan things happen, the selection committee has met without the captain or the coach, because both the captain and the coach have expressed Babar would play, but they have not heeded to any of their advice. They have met secretly. And the news has come out that these three gentlemen have been dropped.
Amazing. But is Jason Gillespie still there?
Yes. Jason Gillespie is the coach. And the you know who else was consulted by the selection committee? Was a gentleman called Tony. The pitch curator. The pitch curator who made that great pitch that produced over 7,000 runs.
Real Multan Sultan.
In 5 days has been consulted, and he said yes, you should drop Babar. That is the reason why you lost this test, not the pitch that I gave you, and please use the same pitch.
Yeah, man.
Like watching this test match reminded me a lot of watching India in the early 90s actually. Like,
is this another Ganguly reference?
Pakistan scoring like 300 for 3 and stuff like that, and we were all getting super excited here. A couple of the English commentators came out complaining, crying about the pitch and all. And we were all like, oh, this racist thing again. What is their problem? And stuff like that. And Murli behaved like one typical like filter copy speaking Tata, who's like seen all of this. Hey, we score like, we are scoring 300 on this pitch. You wait for Australia, that David Boone, Alan Border, all to come. They will score like 500, 600. That's exactly how it panned out, basically. It's very reminiscent of that, because like a classic throwback. And also like Murli mentioned, like where else do you see the team dropping their best bowlers after losing a test match and all that? Pakistan did exactly the same thing two test matches back, where they dropped Naseem and Shaheen after the loss to Bangladesh. So it's nothing new. I mean, incredible how that team is running. Like, they had like this wonderful selection committee meeting along with five mentors, apparently the so-called five mentors, one of whom, Sarfaraz Ahmed, happened to be in the test squad also. So they didn't involve the captain and coach in that discussion. Sarfaraz, who was in the test squad, happened to be part of that discussion. Unbelievable how Pakistan cricket is going. I also have a theory how Aleem Dar got into the selection committee. I think the Pakistan selection board also has this rule about umpires being uncapped before being eligible to be part of the selection panel. So that's why he had to retire, like show cooling off period and stuff like that. Now he's back in the selection committee. Incredible scenes in Pakistan. I've been like looking up whether Jason Gillespie has an autobiography till date, actually. Like, I mean, this is like the one phase of his cricketing career that I would be so like would look forward to read like anything. This guy is a legend in cricket, man. And like last 4 or 5 months he must be pulling his hair out and like wondering what the hell have I signed up to.
But you know who's the happy guy now? Gary Kirsten, because there's no white ball cricket happening.
So all said and done, for whom it may concern, as the stamp of authority on all the WTC tables, Pakistan are bottom at 9 out of 9 with 16.67%, right? Just below West Indies and like several launches below Bangladesh and New Zealand. And like several records have tumbled, right? But I think the most interesting stat has belonged to Cow Stats, who's not Cow Stuff from our podcast, but who brings up interesting trivia, but this one basically stood out, right? Which is that whenever a team has been 556 all out in this century, they've lost, right? So Australia scored 556 in 2003, lost to India. Bangladesh scored 556 in 2012 against West Indies and lost, and apparently Pakistan this time. So 556-inch chest, not good, guys. Like, please avoid.
Since you brought up the WTC, I think there is an even like more interesting stat about the WTC table, if I'm not wrong as things stand. I think England have got more penalty points than Pakistan have got points in the WTC table, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah, this is correct. Correct. Pakistan have 16 points and Pakistan have 16 points and England have 19 penalty points. Yeah, that is right. To be fair, Pakistan have only played 8 tests and England have played 17. Why let facts get in the way of a good stat? So yeah, you're right.
No, but Murli, you should please read out your message that you sent on day one, because everyone was gloating about Shaan Masood and Aga Salman and all that. Only Murli Sathgopan, the one gentleman in the entire universe, had the audacity to speak the truth. Please tell everyone.
I was so confident that when you guys were talking about it, see, everybody, like I said, there is no redemption arc in this story. There are only redemption distractions in this. It acts like one, so it's a smokescreen before they come out like they're finally as the shit they are, right? Having scored like whatever, I think they were 360 or for 4 or 6 or something on day end of day one, they were scoring faster as well. It was not just the fact that they were scoring runs, which was very rare for Pakistan. They were scoring it at a rate unheard of. Hitherto unknown. It was a 5 or 4.5 runs per over something.
More than 4 and over, yeah.
And it was like, what is happening? And you should see, that's the stamp I saw, where everybody is coming and hitting the bowlers, right? People are walking in, South Shakil's walking in, and there is, you know this word gate, there is a gate in South Shakil's walk. And then Shaan Masood is like, he's tapping and he's watching the ball go as he slowly walks to the partner, the gentle like fist bump. It's like he's leading the charge so beautifully, right? That there are parts of this match where you don't know where the captain is. I'll give you a beautiful example. Shaheen Shafridi is trying to bounce out Harry Brook, okay? He's left the entire offside open. There's one point or backward point. Offside fully open. He's trying to bounce out. Harry Brook is like, I think he's 20-year-old kid, okay? He's like standing like this and whacking through mid-off twice in a row. And first they're showing Shaheen Shafridi's face like, what is happening? Then they're showing Rizwan's face like, what is happening? I'm like, neither of them should be taken concern here. Where is Shaan Masood? Like, he needs to ask why there is no fielder, why the bowler is bowling like this. He's not even in the frame. He was absolutely clueless. There were parts of times Abrar was bowling while I think he wanted to go take like a smoke break. Like, Abrar was coming and he's like, okay, take these 6 balls quickly. I have to go for my smoke break. I'll finish it off. You know how the last 4 lines of code you have to finish before smoke break? Like, yeah, 6 balls, take it. 4 foot tosses, 2 short balls, take it. Finish it off. Like, I was like, boy, you guys are going through the motions. There were times they followed the ball. Like, the ball was Modi and they were Amit Shah. Like, the ball used to go. They used to slowly follow at an equal distance. I was like, this is too funny, man. I cannot watch international cricket like this.
Chili Puducherry ko vanakkam.
Exactly.
If there is ever a case for AI getting into cricket, right, and bring back EA Cricket 97 or something, I feel like these test matches in Pakistan should just be simulated, man. Because beyond a point, it's just like painful to like even follow, let alone watch. Like, what is this rubbish? I mean, I'm not a Puritan and all, but this is just like, it was not even pleasing to watch. I don't know. Like, did you enjoy it, Max Davinci, as someone who follows all the cricket in the world?
I was also on the joke train on day one, right? Because Anderson was somewhere playing golf, despite being that bowling coach. And it's like, you know, bowling coach is playing golf, and here they're giving Shaan Masood centuries and all. No? So it was fun on day one. But then, and immediately, they got the first wicket also, right away. Okay, wicket gone. And I was the one who put a message. They only need to get two more wickets, guys. They only need Root and baby KP. That is it. Test match is over. Those are the only two wickets they did not get.
Correct.
And
They got. Give them some credit, yeah, man. Like, both of them were dismissed. Like,
they didn't get. Root had exhausted all the shots that he had to play. So now he's like, I don't know what other shot to play.
Wait, once again, was there a point at which he was actually batting left-handed? Or like, was he just switch-hitting?
No. He took the stance. He took the stance itself left.
Oh, he was like, stamp of authority by Ganguly, I will also show.
Root was operating at a different level. Da. He was playing cricket like, I don't know why I'm getting these kind of bowlers and all. This is boring for me. Like, he was playing some shots where he paused like that for an extra 5-6 seconds. He's like, it's okay, what is there? Some nice video cameras are there, let them take some shots. Like, they are twacking them left, right and center. And every shot of Root is like a you can like properly keep that as a GIF in like your room or something, like that Hogwarts GIF kind of a shot. Like this is shot for like the that most number of runs was a beautiful straight drive, for 100 was a switch hit. Like he's just constantly like breaking records. It's not worth it to talk about Pakistan. Like nothing was good about it. But I do would tell you this, Babar Azam also dropped a catch there. Babar Azam got
not
a very,
catch,
very
absolute sitter. It was an absolute yeah. sitter.
He was not even on 100. Barely hit 100 and then Babar dropped and then just completely out.
Yeah. No, and even I think the bowlers also, right? After a point, they were like, are these guys going to declare? Because the, like Murli said, they were trying to bounce them out, but there was no one behind. They were trying to bowl full, but then there is no long on or long off. So it, nothing was making sense. It's like, why are you trying to do this? Right? They're just hoping that, okay, they will maybe miss hit. Maybe they will make a mistake. Maybe we'll get a wicket. Like they had also given up at this point. And like Amir Sohail and these other guys also were feeling bad for, in the commentary box. Ramiz Raja was like nonchalant. Like, okay. It's okay. I'm here to do my job, but it was pretty bad, man. It brought back memories of the 952.
This is the only innings in which seven bowlers went for over 100 runs, right? Just checking the scorecard. I don't think there will be
any other match. I think there was one other instance. I read up somewhere. I think there was one other instance of this.
Was this on your PC in EA Cricket or something like that?
No, but like controversial like question, but test cricket back to Pakistan, like has that been a good thing or a bad thing for Pakistan cricket?
I think net result is they're happy that their spectators are getting to watch something, but what they're getting to watch is the gladiator kind of games where their team only is the ones being thrown in and other people are coming in as like, people who...
If you actually see on day three, there was more crowd as they were cheering for Brooke and Root.
Yeah.
Brooke was like just hitting it so hard, man. So hard. When he hit Abrar for some six over long on, it was just like absolute disdain.
Yeah.
And he was just hitting them. Just like, see, I have erased all memories of 952 for six. I just know it as a scorecard. I don't even remember individual scores anymore. I only know the score. I know Nilesh Kulkarni played that game. Nothing else. I've completely compartmentalized my brain. I don't know if Mahanama was there or Jaisurya was there, or Aravind. I don't know anything. But I am only thinking now, this would be that 952 moment for people in Pakistan, right? And especially at what time. At least when we had that drubbing, it was before that also, we were good before that. After that also, we got good. So it was, you could think, okay, that was like a, few bad games in Sri Lanka kind of a thing. This is not like that. Like you've lost to Bangladesh and then you are coming and these guys are bludgeoning you. After that, they say you're going to play in the same pitch again. And we'll also take off three of your most experienced guys or the guys who have been on your top 10 ICC list or whatever. We're going to take those guys also away. I just don't know. This is like, remember there's one zombie game. You have to shoot zombies. They'll keep coming at you. You'll shoot the leg. The zombie will still keep crawling. You'll shoot the other leg. Zombie will keep crawling. That is how Pakistan feels like now. They're just like, led to slaughter and then they're just shooting. That's how it feels. It feels like very sad, actually.
What is the next version of book cricket, right? It is Brook cricket in Pakistan. Like, apparently six innings, 785 runs, 400s or something, and an average of 130. I don't know if this is the latest, but...
It is 785
Brook in Pakistan
runs.
Is some,
Out of a career of 1875 runs. 1875 runs is his test career. 785 have come in Pakistan. He has scored more runs in Pakistan than in England. In England, he has scored only 761.
He had played three test matches before this and he had 300s. And in his first test match here, he has 300. Like, that's the way he's going. He's just like fighting
geometric
up the runs.
Progression. He's going in geometric progression. What is this?
Imagine you are a Pakistani. You have to tell people, we had a home whitewash to Bangladesh and it was not our worst moment this year. Like, how can you say a sentence like that and go to sleep at night? Because you think you have a moment of some happiness or something like that, and it becomes the worst test in the history of Pakistan. Like, people will not forget it for a long, long time. That's how low this test was.
Yeah, but if they forget it, they can always come back and listen to this podcast.
But here's the thing, right? Even after they scored all those mountain of runs, I still thought, okay, four sessions, maybe these guys will... it is still a road, right? It was not going to turn or anything. So I thought these four sessions, these guys will still score and they will take it to a draw or something. You know, I don't think England was also playing for a win. England also thought, okay, let's just come and get some this thing. Second and third test, we'll try to think of a win. But then that that third innings from Pakistan was absolute nuts. If you look at it, that's exactly how that first test against Bangladesh also went, right? That third inning is where they completely brain faded and collapsed. Even here, it was hilarious because Babar had come, she hit a four. And everyone was like, you know, when you are stuck in a rut, shots like that get you out of the rut and they put you back on track. And next ball, he has edged to Jamie Smith.
It's too horrible, man. Can't watch it.
The match was over after the second innings. The match was over after the second innings because batting is irrelevant in Test cricket.
Hey, Vamu, do you work for Cricinfo? Should we tell your employees about what is this?
Batting is irrelevant. Fielding is overrated. What is this, guys?
The more I think about it, right, there were many periods of this. You know how there are periods of the game, right, where somebody has a session or something like that. Like Pakistan, I think after the first 6 hours, I think they just played as dead people. Like after the first days, first few hours, I don't think anybody realized they were part of this game at all. They just went through the motions, finished it and came out. There were two, three other catches they had dropped. The fielding had completely gotten off the rails. I don't think there's anything that they can change at all. I think they're just going to go take another loss after this comfortably. They'll be like, what can we do to reduce the shame from the second loss? But this is the best we can do. I don't think as a team we're capable of mustering more from the series.
Guys, root, man. Something else. This, you can say, okay, bad bowling. You can say bad road of a pitch. Whatever you can say. You still got to make the runs, man. And the way he was hitting, it was not like how Brook was hitting. This was like very, like he had taken time, you know, he's like, he's like you're using a sewing machine, not machine, looking at thread. I'm like, I'll sit, okay, there on fielder, there on fielder. He's sitting, waiting. It's almost like, there's a Sindhi movie called,
Joe wrote Bole Kawa Kate.
No, it's a Shah Rukh Khan movie called Chamatkar, okay, where Nasruddin Shah plays, it's a remake of a Mallu movie, I forgot the Mallu movie name.
Oh, really?
Nasruddin Shah plays a ghost.
Chamatkarangal.
Who helps them in a cricket game. So, but that's how it happens, right? The ball is coming and then Nasruddin Shah stops time and then he moves the ball where he wants to put and then, you know, the time starts again. That's how it was when Root was playing. It's like the bowler is bored. He has stopped, seen everything. Okay, those two guys, I'm going to hit there and then he has hit the shot. That much amount of time he has, and it's like, you cannot describe that in words the way Joe Root was batting. Okay, Brook, Duckett, Crawley, all they were like expected lines only. You know, they didn't have Ashwin, so that's what happens. When you don't have a champion spinner, this is what happens, guys. Pakistan, England will come and do like this in same Asia. Once you have someone like Ashwin, then you will know. Poor chaps.
Or Shardul Thakur, da. I feel like Shardul and Root are a match made in
heaven. So, but man, what are they? Everyone was like, first, like, how dare you can say he can catch Sachin? And like, man, guys, not even going on that plane. He's operating a different level now. He's like playing esports cricket with everybody.
He's able to drive on the up away from the body. He's breaking all the rules and all. He's like, screw it. I'm going to score runs everywhere. And there were periods where he was hitting good balls also for boundaries. It was just like, it didn't matter to him anymore. But amidst all of this, if there was one positive I'll take for this shitty Pakistan, I really do want to appreciate Naseem Shah though. I think there were periods in his bowling and finally even in his batting that I truly enjoyed. And you have to understand, there are people like me and Mayur who'll sit and watch even this kind of a test match properly in front of a TV for 4 hours. Naseem Shah gave periods of bowling where it was definitely at least a little testing to score runs. And then while batting, he scored some amazing boundaries, proper sixes. It was at least worthwhile to see him play. But apart from that, I think there was zero positives for this Pakistan. And I'll tell you another funny thing is, there was a point where everybody, and even the English commentators, said that this is an absolute road. Like nothing is going to happen. Nobody can find anything on this pitch. There's nothing to find on this pitch. But England found it. On day four, England found it. Like the ball moved a little. It seemed a little... And you've seen that meme with that Zimbabwe Na Kheloto song that Babar was playing with, where he gets out to that nick. I've seen that 100 times. The ball does not move, but Babar makes it look so good. It's like, what just happened? Oh, I just got out to a great ball. It was a straight ball. He nicked it and he walked. That's all.
Yep. Same Kohli transference has happened where suddenly you feel like you're getting out to Jaffa. But guys, speaking of the WTC and the next leg and like Kohli and all of that, what is the news that Rohit Sharma is probably going to miss a test in BGT and all? Is this like the rite of passage for an Indian cricket test captain great? Like, what is, why is Rohit missing the Perth test?
If you want to win BGT, means you're playing without your first choice captain. This and all, you don't know, ma.
Yeah, so somewhere in Mumbai, Ajinkya Rahane is checking visa validity for Australia. But like, what is happening? Like, why is this not like, is it the same? Like,
personal birth, reasons.
Birth equal to birth. Is this the thing?
Maybe, yeah, most likely. In a way, you know, as fans, you think like, okay, you know, why this is happening. But in a way, you also think of it like, you know, finally, players have the agency to go back and be with their families when they need them the most, which, you know, was probably unheard during a Dravid or a Sachin and Kumble's time. But now, you know, this generation, they have the agency to do it, which is credit to Jesha, you must say.
They are able to... Legend in cricket administration.
Yeah, you know, never happened in the previous administrations. They couldn't, they were scared to even say that, you know, their wives have all gone on public saying that, you know, they were alone and all that. But yeah, see, all of you hate him, man. But this is the change he's brought about. He's brought about a different culture, you know, families first, happy families equals happy cricketers. Yeah. And you're seeing it.
Yeah, I mean, at least this reason has no explanation, but I believe Yash Dayal, who was slotted to play in the New Zealand Test Series, has suddenly picked up an injury, so he can remain uncapped for the IPL. What are the calculations here? Is this true? Wamu, like, what do you understand?
Nay, this and all is still okay, because at least he would have still not made the playing 11 and all that. Best was yesterday, like third T20 international, India versus Bangladesh. So, India had this uncapped bowler called Harshit Rana. Who by chance happens to be like a KKR fast bowler also. And the entire Indian support staff, all ex-KKR guys. In fact, Morne Morkel or Abhishek Nair, who in the morning of that game or the night before said like, we are looking to give the full bench a go. So, Harshit is all set to like, make his debut and all that. Like 5 minutes before the toss, like BCCI puts out a tweet, Harshit Rana has picked up a bug or something. He's down with a viral fever and has not traveled with the team. somebody on Twitter like posted like, I hope Harshit Rana knows about the viral fever that Harshit Rana is supposed to be down with.
No, I also saw one which said, Venky Mysore, apne account se aao.
As I am suffering from uncapped player fever. Guys, please excuse.
No, but Vamu and me will do a complete debrief about the IPL. That will be a separate 3-hour podcast.
Like that, okay.
We should talk about what you kind of teased in the intro. About the Chetan.
It's a long time coming.
I know, the Chetan. Please take it away, Tony. You have made an appearance on the pod after a very long time. A certain someone also has made an appearance on the field after a very long time. So like a string of innings where he was taking ducks and single digit scores and everyone was, you know, even Shashi Tharoor has stopped tweeting about him. He suddenly showed up and now Tony has showed up with intros that have been, you know, proper and not made up shit. So, Tony,
what,
please.
What to say, man? Like, except this.
What was that post-100 celebration of his? You know, people kiss the bat, people can blow kisses to the crowd, people sometimes, you know, bow to the ground, some people point to the bat, some people point to their number, all kinds of things they say. What is this wagging your tongue thing? Is there some cultural reference?
It was a delicious 100, delectable 100.
No, that was not licking your... It was not smacking your lips and it was not like doing chef's kiss and all. It was like a very Salazar Slytherin snake type thing.
Snake Babu.
So, I need to ask Tony, Is this like some movie reference that he was trying to do, which none of us got or something? I don't know.
Not that I know of.
Because Murli has a snake babu, which is Vadivelu, but I don't think Samson would do that.
My interpretation, first of all, it's against Bangladesh, so Nagin snake celebrations are very much in order, so you stick your tongue up. Second is probably you keep wagging your tongue, man. I will that and show you how good I am, maybe.
Ooh.
And like he ended it with, it was just pure joy, right? Just to see how the team went about it. And I think all said and done, like we've been critical of Gautam Gambhir coming into the mix and all that. To be fair, they've shown the most aggressive brand of cricket that we've seen, right? And they've stepped it up periodically from the Kohli era to the Rohit era to now the Sky era, where like people are like, just go for your shots, right? It doesn't matter. Previous failures and shit like that doesn't matter. They're like, okay, you open, you do your thing, and let's see how it goes. And I think exemplified by that one over when he just went for like... six out. Also, it didn't, I mean, helped him immensely that Rishabh just kept bowling the same ball. Like, what is happening? Like, four balls in a row, he just did the same thing. Then he went around and, like, bowled one more, which went for the fifth, six. The honest thing, right, and I know, at least for people who don't know, I've written a 3,749-word article about Sanju Samson, which Sanju himself read and said, like, he's like, yeah, you get me, right? And his philosophy has never changed. It's been like, if the ball is there to be hit, I'll hit it. Whether I'm on 0 or 49 or 96, it doesn't matter, I'm going to hit it. So I'm glad it has finally come off, man. It's a long fucking time coming. And I feel like you could see the relief on his face also. So hopefully it builds some momentum and results in something big time for him.
So let us first address the elephant in the room. Okay, it has been established that you, Tony, you are not the pitch curator at Rawalpindi. Okay, at least
correct. This is true.
But can you deny that you are not the mentor of Sanju Samson? Who told him to hit five sixes in an over? Not four, not six. Five sixes in an over. Are you that mentor?
I wish it was me, right? No, but it's Raifi, Raifi Gomez. So here's a fun, like in that, like the big article I wrote of him, which is like a compilation of multiple interviews he'd done and all of that. So he's not a guy who's like prone to hyperbole in that sense, right? Like, in fact, like the first time he got into RR, basically, Rahul Dravid was pricked by Srishant saying, sir, this guy is a big player. I've seen him in local circuit. He's hit six sixes and all that. And Sanju's relating the story saying, I had never done that, but he said it. So that's how I got it. Right? So probably is something he's been deliberately practicing over a period of time. Right? It just came off at the right time. He's not one who shies away from trying to go for the big one either. So anyway, when it pays off, it pays off. It is just... probably just like a law of averages kind of thing that it came off at least.
It is actually. Let me make a say. The last 10 Sanju innings in T20 internationals have been 13, 1, 40, 0, 12, 0, 0, 29, 10, and 111. And he had the twin ducks in Sri Lanka in Palakkale. So, you know, at that time, everyone was like, this is not going to happen. Yeah. But credit to Gauti for keeping persisting with him and despite the first two games in the series as well, like I thought that Gwalior game was ready for the taking for him, and then again there he kind of perished at 29. So but I think this has been a thing which we have spoken about Sanju even during the IPL and all as well. It is this attitude of his, this which people say, okay, selfless attitude or whatever, is that which also is his downfall, right? And at some point, all batters have to be selfish. Because when you say selfish, it's like, it's not that you want to make a 50. But you make a 50 and your team also makes a 50 only then, right? You get out at 10 and then afterwards the next guy comes in and, you know, he faces a bad ball. If you are set, if you are there at 25, that's what Gavaskar would say, right? But you have to do, you have to be a little selfish. And that is not there, which, you know, we are hailing as his greatest trait and all that. But it also his biggest weakness.
See, two things. One, before I hand over the mic. One is that this boy also plays one-day cricket, right? And he plays it very differently. Usually comes in at number six and usually gets a long run only if the team's in trouble. And his approach is very different. Like he consolidates, then he, you know, make sure he stays till the end, etc., etc. So much so that probably one of his last ODI innings was the one in South Africa where he scored 100, right?
108.
So he always plays a situation, right? And it is very clear that he's not a selfish player, because even when he's an RR captain, except for the last season, I think the previous season he came in at number 4, which is like surefire recipe for disaster if you want to get anywhere. But yeah, that's how he plays, and like that's what makes him like very, very likable, right? That like it doesn't fucking matter, like I'm gonna be the team guy, right? Who either tells you that Jadeja got hit on his head, so maybe we can concussion substitute him in Australia, or just like sits there and like goes for it hell for leather, right? But the other thing that I wanted to say was, it is written that he was supposed to hit 5 sixes in an over, right? Because it is Anju Samson, not R. Samson.
No, no, I think it was very interesting, like the post-match ceremony also, that I think some of the things that Sanju did say, I think one, there was an acknowledgement that this was last chance saloon for him, basically, because I think there was, I mean, he himself admitted that like this management has like backed him, and like their actions have also shown that, and he specifically alluded to the two ducks he made in Sri Lanka and how he was going back to Kerala and was wondering whether he would get picked again yesterday, again in the team. And I think number two, Max mentioned about the Gwalior game. I think after the Gwalior game, I remember Sanju did put out something on his social medias where he said like, this is the way we want to play this game, basically. So I found that also pretty revealing, honestly. And I've never been the biggest Gautam Gambhir fan, honestly. Like the brand of T20 cricket, like this team is playing, and just like this combination is that he's put together, it's I think the best that we have probably ever played, actually. I mean in our history of T20 cricket, I know like absence of Kohli and Rohit has made some of these selections a lot easier, but I would give credit to the management also. I think somebody like a Riyan Parag is not a very obvious pick, basis his performances, etc. Like, I mean, the usual Indian way to go about it is just like pick your 5 best openers and like put them from 1 to 5. But here they have like made some very difficult calls, like leaving out Ruturaj is not an easy call, to be honest. So I think they have taken those calls, and credit to them. And of course, Gavaskar won't agree to that. I mean, even yesterday, I think there was a phase during his commentary stint where he was making the point like how all the credit for the Indian T20 team should go to Surya Kumar Yadav, apparently, because like he is the captain of the side and he has brought in this refreshing change and stuff.
Hey, where is Surya Kumar Yadav from? Mumbai, is it?
Maharashtra.
They have not made a bold choice by not sending Ruturaj Gaikwad. They have told Ruturaj Gaikwad to go play Ranji, because he's already been told he's the third opener. So he's playing Ranji because KL Rahul is there. No seat. Rohit Sharma may come back. No seat. Ruturaj Gaikwad already has been told he's the third opener. And then one more thing I'll tell you. Suri Kumar's statement was yesterday, I'm going to read it out verbatim. We want to be selfless players, selfless team. That has been the talk. Even if you're batting in 49 or 99, if the team wants to hit, then you need to do it for the team. Then, 2 minutes later, Sanju Samson, I told Surya I'll smash it when I was at 96. But Surya told me to go easy. I'm very happy with that kind of clarity I received from Captain and Gauti Bhai.
Hey, he's at 99, Ra, not 96. So till 99 you take, then 99 you hit a 6. That is what Surya meant. Yeah. What Max guy you're doing?
Management, it seems. Manangati, it seems. You know, hey, Bangladesh. Bangladesh also just came lambs to slaughter like things. So India also, okay, it's nothing this thing. India also is playing 2 hype tournaments. They have played the Bangladesh series, now one New Zealand series. So, nice hype tournament so that they can give Gaba Me Hoga Fir Se something, and Star Sports can put some jingoistic nonsense so that then they can go get their asses kicked. This is all part of the plan. England also did the same thing. Okay, they played against who, Alamma? Sri Lanka, West Indies, a great English summer, great successful English summer, Gus Atkinson player of the year or whatever, wisdom nonsense. And then they will come and play. See, all this is hype before they go get their asses kicked by Australia. India also doing same thing only. We'll just do some hype scenes before movie release. That's all.
One second. Max, just to clarify, there are like 9 teams in the world that play cricket. You mentioned like, I think 4 or 5 out of the 9, one being India itself. So the only ones that are excluded basically are Australia and England, whom they are anyway supposed to play. In the lead up to that series, they can't play them. No, obviously they have to play the other teams. Now what is this nonsense? Suddenly Minos, it seems. What rubbish. You guys were like saying, New Zealand big team has made it to World Cup finals of everything that this and the other.
Sir,
one
let
WDC,
me point
suddenly
it,
there are Minos.
Point it out to you. Your friend from a different podcast, Mr. Nitin Sundar, took a flight from Dubai all the way to Gaul to watch Kane Williamson get dismissed twice in the same day.
Even Kane Williamson's wife or mother wouldn't have done that. Right? That is how much you guys are counter-hating my hate for New Zealand.
They have dropped their captain also now for this. They have dropped that Tim Southee is not the captain. He may not even be in the team. That is what is happening.
Who's captain? Rachin.
Tom Latham. Because for sure they know wicketkeeper has to play. And this much nazar you put, Williamson, after being dismissed twice in the day, is not going to play also another first test.
I think they're basically setting up a farewell series for Ashnar. Like this should be it, no? Basically. He has to write more books and all. Like the first book has done well. It's left us at a cliffhanger, basically.
I have the highways. I have the freeways. next level. I keep writing that.
You just wait. Jadeja will wake up with a neck sprain Monday at Adelaide. Then you see who will come out. All you dirty fellows will be sitting in MCG. MCG C stand. All you guys will be sitting from C stand and sending me and giving me updates of how Ashna bowled an absolute ripper to Travis Head.
Dave, why would, like, if Jadeja wakes up with a neck sprain in Adelaide, like, why will we be sitting at C stand in MCG?
Because he will continue from there. The ascendancy will start. He will play Adelaide, Melbourne, Sydney.
The time space continuum thing.
Our own podcast, right? I didn't get it. Like, why were the panelists last week saying who will we play, Ash or Jadeja? In Australia, you always play both, no? It's known. Like, three paces plus two spinners.
Yeah.
What is it? Ash is playing. Like, BGT, he'll play. But
no. Yeah. I think maybe, like, Perth, I don't think Ash will get a go. But, yeah, I'd agree with the other venues. You'd probably go with two spinners for sure. But, like, honestly, like,
they go with 4 fast bowlers because Bumrah also has to captain, is it? He doesn't want to, like, burn himself out by bowling too many overs.
No, I think we'll go with 4 fast bowlers.
It's also same. It's anyway drop-in pitches everywhere, no?
Optus, I think after these drop-in pitches, they like produce some of these big cracks which don't respond to spin bowlers for some reason. But Pat Cummins will start bowling ball of the centuries and all that as the Optus.
This will be brilliant when in Perth, Ashna doesn't play and Travis Head ends up with 4 for 23 or some shit like that to like send Australia.
Labuschagne. Signature Labuschagne stuff.
After Hansi Kronje and this Pakistani spot fixing, I was under the impression that international cricket was like free of match fixing and all that. But what was that Bangladesh performance yesterday, man? Like every third ball was a no ball. Like every second ball was a 6. Like how can an international team be so horrible? Like just beggared belief, to be honest. And this great legend of Bangladeshi cricket, one Mahmudullah, decided that this will be his farewell series. Like yesterday, nobody gave a damn.
Nobody fared well.
Oh, man.
It was really bad. There was the over where he hit him for like 4 sixes and all that, right? I was trying to think, even with like 10-year-old kids, right, playing on the streets and all, you bowl the first ball, you know, you toss it up and he's hitting. By mistake also, by accident, you will bowl the next one short or you will fire it in just to see. He bowled the same ball 4 times. He's like, this time I'll bowl. Maybe you will not believe it. But this time,
double
maybe
bluff,
you'll see.
Triple bluff.
But if there are 3 times, do you think I'll do it again? again, maybe I will. And every time he whacks in the same spot. And I'm like, do you have any brains, dude? Like, try something else. How can you repeat the same thing? This is some really, really horrible bowling. I have never seen. I really thought I'd taken money. At some point, I really had to pause. Because there are moments, you know, like in watching The Office where it's so cringe, you have to tell yourself, no, 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 this is scripted. It is not something he's actually saying. Like, I had to tell myself, this is not scripted. They are actually bowling like this. It's not possible for them to have planned it. The balls were horrendous, man.
It was over 18.1 or 18.2 when they were bowling. They had some like six fielders inside the circle for one of those deliveries. Like, just like lost it completely.
They have no idea what to do.
Again, that also is double bluff. It's like, you know, you think, okay, they're going to bouncer, we'll ball full ball. And then Riyan Parag just hits it over. But guys, you know, okay, Sanju played well. Yeah, Nitish played well. Hardik Pandya, macha.
Hardik Pandya.
What is that? Even in stick cricket also, you don't have those shots. You don't have the shots in stick cricket also, macha.
But I have to give the best shot of the day to Sanju Samson, man. Even though Hardik Pandya's was a mind-blowing shot that he executed, Sanju Samson's shot defied physics, man. What the fuck? Falling backwards on a back foot and punching it
over. Mustafizur Rahman, right? Yeah.
Oh, that was some... At that point of time, it looked like, you know, how you have gotten that... in Indian gods, you'll have that big form where they stand big. They've grown 10x in size. It looked like that. Sanju looked like a person who could hit anything. He had played some great straight drives. He had cut and pulled and all that. That one shot over extra cover was...
Yeah.
He keeps saying he's a big fan of Rajinikanth, right? So he showed how to defy physics like his...
Exactly.
Yeah, but yeah, that shot of Mustafizur was just poetry. Like, it's been on reels. I've seen that reel quite a few times. But Hardik, not just this match, right? Even like all the three games.
Hardik, then the shot behind the wicket, man.
This Hardik reminded me of 2019... Pre-COVID Hardik, right? When he was at Mumbai at MI Indians with Pollard and he.
Oh,
he would just walk out. This is 11 balls, 34, all that nonsense he would come and hit. No, but when he was not... Because even when he was a captain at Gujarat, he was kind of okay. Mumbai became as captain, he was okay. But even with the India ODIs, even the India T20s that he was like, against the Australia T20, he was a captain. He was a captain for, I think, some New Zealand T20s and all that. He was like, okay there. This Hardik is good. This Hardik augurs really well. And if he can carry this into the Champions Trophy, I think that'll be fabulous. Like, where he's completely unshackled and just going absolute nuts. I mean, it also helps that he's getting all that cushion from the top order. Right? So he's walking in, licensed to... just.
Who's in the top order?
For two games, a certain Malayali was there who absolutely stank. And then when it did not matter... It was actually supposed to be.
There is no such thing as clutch. There is no such thing.
It was supposed to be a farewell game for some Bangladesh player. He came and stole the Apollo's thunder, and then said century. Even then, he had to still pray and do some this thing to baby Jesus in Velangani, because Sky also was going to score a century. He had to pray that Sky doesn't score a century yet again and steal his thunder. So. All that had
Sky's innings is something that people wouldn't just... I don't think they noticed what was happening, because apparently Sanju Samson scored the fastest 50 against Bangladesh. I don't even know why those things are records. In 22 balls. Just for fun, Sky scored in 23. Like, he took one extra ball to score his 50 and then continued muscled on to 75. There were runs flowing everywhere. But amidst all of this, like Mohanlal and Jailer, Hardik Pandya walked in for only like 10 or 12 minutes, man. And in that 12-minute section, it's just straight reels. Continuous reels moments after reels moments. There are shots that look like a proper slap, like a Malayali slap. He'll come and like slap one straight over there, then whack one over covers. He's looking, man, and there's so much swagger.
Forehand jab, man. He had one forehand jab. I think it was of Tuskin only, I think.
Yes.
Or mid-wicket. It's like, what is this? This should not be allowed.
You know how in the day they used to... wash clothes like that. And the Mari was like one straight swag whacked into the stands.
I have this theory that Hardik has put in a lot of work in the lead up to this T20 series, because I mean, there were certain like systemic deficiencies that had crept into his T20 batting. I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of that has also been driven by all the noise around the retentions that Mumbai Indians will do, basically. I think that's going to be an interesting one to watch. And this is like Hardik Pandya's like way of telling Mumbai Indians that release me at your own peril now. So there is any question of Mumbai Indians doing anything but like retain Hardik Pandya as their captain. There was this noise that like they may go back to
the way. Why are you talking about IPL? I just know I told we'll put one different episode for IPL and talk about IPL.
Save all these gems for that episode, which will be a subscriber special. So none of us have to listen to this shit.
It'll be on our upcoming Patreon channel.
Oh man, dude, I think I've said this before, that Bits and Pieces needs to have a subscriber model where we edit out the shit that you were about to talk about IPL. Like, it'll be like the cleaned up version where you don't have to listen to this nonsense.
No, but
guys, like yesterday was record breaking in many ways, and India notched up the second highest T20 international score. I think men's and women's combined, don't come at me saying women, some Belinda Clark something and all happened. I don't know. Like, anyway, I believe like the highest is Nepal against Mongolia. But the best was India should have crossed 300, but they landed up at 297. And the tweet of the day, week, century goes to the person who said, Gambhir will always fall 3 runs short.
Since you mentioned Belinda Clark, it dawned upon me that there is one more tournament happening right now.
There is a World Cup, apparently.
It's called a World Cup, that is happening. And it is actually in a very interesting stage right now, because the semifinals are getting decided, where right now India, New Zealand, Tony's favorite team, are fighting for that second spot from the one group. And in the other group, though South Africa has 3 wins, England and West Indies are fighting for that other spot. It is, today is Sunday, as well as time we're recording, both games are going to be done by the time you listen to this episode.
What's not sure about what's going to happen later today against Australia? Da? I'm pretty sure about what's going to happen. I don't know. They threw in one patriotic sentence like Bharat Mata ki jai jai. 100% we know what's going to happen. There is no surprise there. There was
Texas and Australian women winning.
Yeah.
The World Cup they will win, I'm not telling. But today Aliza Hilly may not play. Therefore, there is a sliver of a chance that they can, make the top 4.
Aliza Hilly may play, may not play. There is no healing this, Rav. We are definitely losing. We have to nurse those wounds only. There was a time where we were like, 90s Australia, we cannot beat them. Now both men and women are doing it. They are coming and beating everybody and we are just sitting there and crying. I don't think there's any chance we can like beat these Australian women. Even if we do get that surprise win, it'll give us unnecessary hope that India could be that monster killer or whatever. Then they'll crush us so badly like Ricky Ponting did. We'll be like, yeah, sorry, we were wrong. We hoped too fast. This is all we know.
Nice, you're confusing Aliza Healy with Achilles heel. Both are different things.
Okay. Well, no one's very upbeat about India's chances. Maybe when you're listening to the episode, you will all be nodding your head with that great exposition from Murali Sadgopan. But it is the inevitable. Death, taxes,
when,
and
when is
Australia.
The final next Sunday? Next Sunday?
That will be next Sunday only.
Cool. Which country is this happening in? Let me ask.
Dubai. Dubai, right?
Sharjah.
So apparently, I think India are playing an international game in Sharjah after 20 years or something today.
Indian women or like India?
No, all India men or women basically.
Women.
Man, it's a severe punch to the gut to remind us how old we are.
We played World Cup, no, there. We didn't
play
Sharjah.
No, that was only... No,
no games in Sharjah.
Only IPL.
Sharjah.
Only IPL we played. In that, on that note of the Sharjah shakeup, I think this has been episode 142 of Bits and Pieces. With a firm promise that from now on, we'll put out an episode every week, hopefully. Unless Nitto says otherwise, and because it is his birthday week, we have to consider his feelings also. But otherwise, most likely, we'll be back every week from now. As Sanju Samson will continue opening for India in T20s, ODIs, very shortly in Test cricket. Until that glorious day. This is Tony, Max, Varun and Murali signing off. Say bye, guys.
See you.
Bye.
Bye, guys.